Hi, in this video, I will show you the handling, input and calculation of buckling lengths in SCIA Engineer. My name is Ivan Beleš. Now we see in SCIA Engineer a very simple steel structure. The first task we have to do is to check the buckling lengths and show them on the display and with table results. After the calculation, you can go to the steel menu, to the beams, and you find this function slenderness. Then you can select some beams you want to display, for example, these ones, and change the selection to current. And now you can select which property you want to view, see. There is a buckling length around strong axis, buckling length around weak axis, K is the buckling length factor, the uppercase L is the system length, and the lowercase l is the buckling length. So, for example, we want to see the buckling length factor around strong axis for these beams. And I see 2.46. But I don't know the system length. The system length is with this L, so 5 meters, the wall length of the beam, and times 2.6, we get the buckling length. So this is, if you want to see it in the graphical results, you can see it also with the preview. Then you get the table with the system length, buckling length factor, and buckling length, and you can get it, of course, also in a table results and export, for example, to Excel. That's the one possibility how to do it. The another possibility is, after the calculation, of course, you can select a beam and go to the buckling length settings. This is the main point for the settings of buckling length in SCIA Engineer for the part. It's not for beam. I explain later. And then you click on these buttons with 3 points, and then you get a table. You get the graphic of this beam, and on this second page results, you get also the buckling lengths and the system length and buckling length factor. So you see the same like in the steel results. Okay, that was very simple, only to display the values, and now a little bit explanation. What we have? We have a small beam, small structure, for example, a frame. And to calculate the buckling length, first what we need is the length of the beam. This is with L with uppercase, and this times buckling length factor, you get buckling length with a lowercase l. And the L is buckling length factor times system length. So buckling length is buckling length factors times system length. Then you see in SCIA Engineer the Y or Z. What is it? The beam have local coordinate system Y, Z axis, and the X axis is the beam axis. This is the X. For example, this is our beam, so in this direction is going Z, and in the another direction, in the depth, we have the Y axis. So the buckling around Y axis is marked with this double epsilon, so buckling length around Y axis is L Y Y. These are the main axes of the beam. For example, if you have an angle, then you have the buckling length around this main axis. It's in Eurocode in the explanation, and it's every time around main axis. You have to be careful if you rotate a beam. If you rotate a beam with the rotation of local coordinate system, then you have again Y and Z, nothing happened. But if you rotate only with the alpha in this horizontal position, then the y and z axis remain on the old place and only the cross section will be rotated around your angle. You see it in the engineer. I will display it on this only with the 3D view of the beams, and we will look also on the local coordinate system, local axis of members, and so then we see both of them. So, and also maybe the cross section. I explain it extra because during the cross section, during the trainings for my customers, I explain it, but don't know if everybody knows about it. So this is the non-rotated cross section, and you can rotate with this local coordinate system rotation, and you say this is Y and this is Z. If I rotate it, the results have to be deleted. Should undo it before. And then you see Y and Z is rotated, beam is rotated too. Go back and I rotate only with this alpha. Then the coordinate system remains on the old position, only cross section have changed. So and now the buckling around Y axis is around the weak axis. So you have to be careful by reading the results and the buckling lengths because there are no exchange. So simply, if possible, rotate the coordinate system. The cross section is rotating with the coordinate system. Okay. I remove this local axis from the screen. Okay, that's enough. Okay, that was first explanation about the coordinate system, about the buckling length, that very basic. And now we will look on the internal calculation of the buckling length. SCIA Engineer have three possibilities how to input or calculate buckling lengths. There is one internal calculation. This internal calculation works with stiffness of the nodes of a beam and stiffness, bending stiffness of the beam. Then there is, of course, manual input. Then you decide which buckling length you want to input. And then there is also the stability method. From the stability calculation, from the buckling shape, you can calculate in SCIA Engineer the buckling length. So we will go over all these things. The basic for all the inputs is, I will delete this. So the basic is the system length of the beam. Our structure is not so simple like I have drawn in the first picture. We have a frame which have splitted columns. Our column is around strong axis as one beam, and around weak axis we have two parts, around weak axis, and this is around strong axis. This will check SCIA Engineer, and you don't need to draw this column with one beam. You can draw it as one beam, of course, like in our model, but you can also draw two beams. If all these beams are in the same line, so that means in the straight line, and there is no hinge between them, they go in the same direction and have the same rotation, also with different cross sections, then the engineer connect these beams to one system length. And also, if you create one beam with intermediate points like polygon, then also if it is 180 degrees, that means the straight line, then it's one system length. And here, if you want, okay, that's the first explanation. Our beam, our column, is split in two parts and it's connected. So this beam is connected to the column. It's done automatically during the calculation. Then SCIA Engineer looks in each structural node if there is a beam which is going orthogonally or with an angle less than 45 degrees from this orthogonal direction. And then the engineer says, aha, this is splitted member to two system lengths or more system lengths. And this is done in this direction. And also if you look from the top view and there is a going one member also in this some angle. And if this angle is smaller than 45 degrees, then it's splitted. And then the engineer says this is one system length and another system length. In this direction, we have nothing. And then this is one system length. Of course, if you have some cantilever beams, for example, here, then it's free. There is nothing. Then the engineer says, okay, this is in this direction one beam and this is then another beam and it's free on the end. We will see. This is how the engineer decides how to split the length of the beam to system lengths. You have influence on it. So if you go to SCIA Engineer and look on the beam in this system lengths, then you will see around strong axis. Now we are in the definition around strong axis. This is our beam. This is the Y axis and this is around strong axis. That means in this direction, we will define the buckling length. Around strong axis, there is no beam in this direction. And the engineer sees there is a node, but this node is not, have not, don't have a support or another beam. So this is a free and can move. Around weak axis, there is also this node, but there is a beam in this 90 degree direction and then it's split. If you decide it should be not done, we will see it on the purlins, then you can deactivate it. You can deactivate it here, but you can go to the buckling length constraints and you can deactivate it also here in the table. And also for the around strong axis, you can activate, deactivate. So this is the definition of the system lengths. System lengths are very important because the buckling length factor will be multiplied with the system length and then you get the buckling length factor. Okay, then you see here sway around strong axis, sway around weak axis. What is it? There is an internal calculation of the buckling lengths. And this internal calculation works on following principle. First, the engineer split the members, 1D members, to columns and beams. Column is everything which is vertical or with an angle smaller than 10 degrees from the vertical. This is a column. All another 1D members are beams. Columns will be loaded with continuous load in global X direction with 10 kN per meter and in Y direction, QY, also with 10 kN per meter. All another beams will be loaded in local direction of the beam in Z direction with 180 newton per meter. I explain it only if you want to calculate your manual example and compare the results. And you should also know what's happened in the background. And in the y direction with 0.1 newton per meter. This is the load in both direction, to the right, to the left, to the in y direction and opposite direction. And from these loads, we get bending moments. For example, this one. And we get also rotation of our nodes. And of course, we look on the start point and end point of the system length, not of the beam. For example, if we would have some another structure which is braced, then we have to look on this bending moment, this and not this one and this one. So we have the rotation on the beginning, rotation on the end point, we have bending moment on the start, bending moment on the end point, then we have the stiffness of the E or J node, which is bending moment divided by the rotation. Then we have also the stiffness of the bending stiffness of the beam. And with all these informations, STIA Engineer goes in two formulas. The first formula is for sway system, and the another formula is for non-sway system. And from all these informations, there are long formulas. You see it in background and also in the description of this video. You have link to the help in STIA Engineer to the chapter where is described this theory. And then you get the buckling length. This is bigger or equal 1, and this is smaller or 1. Something between of them is simple column. Which have two hinges, and then they have the buckling length is 1. It's not calculated, it's simple defined as 1. So this is the internal calculation. Therefore, also we have to define this system length correctly, because from the start and end point of the system length, STIA Engineer calculate this the rotation of the nodes and the bending moments of the nodes. And from all this information, the buckling length. And we have to decide if it is sway or non-sway, because there are these two formulas, and we have to decide with which formula STIA Engineer should calculate the buckling length. This sway and non-sway don't influence the bending moments. Only the formula which is used for the calculation of the buckling length factor with this internal procedure. So we have this sway and non-sway. Where can we decide it? First, you can decide it in the steel menu. If you go to steel setup, then you have the general setting for the wall structure with this default sway type. Around strong axis is defined as sway, means the nodes can move. Around weak axis is the predefined value to no, that means non-sway. Usually you have in the around the weak axis some bracing or walls and something other. But in our structure, I have the wind bracing only in this top field, so I have to calculate this as sway, that means non-braced. And if we now look on our settings, then we will see around strong axis, you see these green arrows, that means this is sway type, it can move. Around weak axis, now we see also arrows. In the previous window, we have seen some cross, that means this is non-sway. So you can change the settings for each beam and for each system length. You can change it here, you can change it also here. And you can change it also sway type to all to non-sway, all to sway, or from setup. We leave it on from setup. Then we have, okay, so we have decided what is the system length and if the engineer should use the formula for sway or non-sway structures to calculate the buckling length factor. Now the engineer have all informations to calculate the buckling lengths for standard frame structures. This calculation is not valid for some arcs or some cupolas or some weird structures. This is for frames. And then we have lateral torsional buckling. And for lateral torsional buckling, you have to define the buckling length factor and also the system length. But we will do it for the beam, not for this column. I go to this beam and go to the system length settings, and then we will see. So around strong axis, of course, we have support only with these two beams. That's correct. Around weak axis, the engineer sees there is a beam which is connected, but we know the bracing goes only to this node and not to this node. So we can deactivate these two nodes and then we can get such buckling length. You can also change the buckling length not to calculate the buckling length factor. We can say we want to input the buckling length factor and this should be one for this structure. For example, it's very simple. So, and then we have the lateral torsional buckling, and the lateral torsional buckling is depending from this Z direction. So we have defined for the buckling around weak axis that we don't have support in this node. So there is no support. We have support only here, here, and here. But for the lateral torsional buckling, we have some purlins, and these purlins, for example, they are connected with four bolts, and they store their support the beam against rotation. So we can say we want to have some extra settings, and you see then we get some new columns. So if I stay on this old definition, I can define only the Z because the lateral torsion buckling is depending from Z. But I want to have extra setting for lateral torsion buckling, and I can activate or deactivate it in the screen or in the table. And now the lateral torsional buckling is going from point to point, and this is the length for a lateral torsion buckling multiplied with this factor 1. We have the lateral torsional buckling length. Okay. Now it's defined and we get a definition with the name BG1, and we can use this definition for similar beams, for another beams which are from steel and which have also four spans. This beam have four spans, and we can use the same definition for another beams also with four spans. So you can see we don't see the BG1 which was defined for the column, because these have only two spans. Of course, I cannot use it for another for beams with another amount of spans. But I can use it for another columns. This is one beam. Okay, it's very simple. But this one are two beams. This is the beam on the bottom and on the top. It's enough to select one of them, and then you can define it. If you check this one, then it's defined already, because this is one system length. I forgot, you can display this system length. You can display it for the full structure with system lengths. Apply, but it's sometimes very weird structure, very weird picture. So better you select the beams for which you want to display it and go to these settings, setup dialog, and display it here. You can display also another informations for the system lengths. It's in labels. Yes, in label system length, name label. So you can get more information than only this very simple name. Okay, let's deactivate it for the full structure. In the structure, deactivate. And let's calculate the structure and check the buckling length. So everything is defined. Usually for these columns, you have what for my structure, only one thing which I have to do is to change the sway type for buckling around weak axis. And then you can go to slenderness, select your columns, for example, these ones, and then look on the buckling length factor 2.646 and buckling length factor around weak axis 2. Okay, let's say I have complicated structure or I want to calculate with a more exact approach, which is general. What can I do? I can calculate stability. For the stability, for my frame, I need loads. These loads have to create pressure, so negative axial force in the beam. That's very important. It's not important how large or how big is my load. Explain. The buckling length is calculated from the Euler formula, P times AE through N critical. N critical is axial force multiplied with the multiplicator factor where the structure lose the stability. And this factor we can calculate with the stability calculation. The axial force we get from our load, there is also self-weight. So you have to be careful if you want to compare these calculations because this is not a constant axial force. We have something like this, which is negative axial force, and SCIA Engineer calculate with this average value of the axial force from the start and end point of the beam. So we calculate the stability calculation. From the stability calculation, we get the buckling shape, and to the buckling shape, we get also this factor, this multiplication factor, and we select from which buckling shape we want to read the buckling lengths for our calculation. There are, of course, many buckling shapes. For example, our structure can get, so this is this structure, it can get buckling shape in this direction to the right, for example. Also buckling shape, let's draw it with red, to the in the y direction. Also some buckling shape with rotation of the structure. Some buckling lengths also for this partial beams, for example, for this one, could be also the first buckling shape. So therefore, don't select the first buckling shape. Look in how the structure is deformed and select your buckling shape. Because if you select the first one, you get the lowest value of this multiplication factor. And with this lowest value, you get also the lowest value of the critical buckling force. And then you get large buckling length. So you are not on the economical side with your calculation. How to do it in SCIA Engineer? First, we need this load. Then we have to divide the beams to more finite elements. It's only settings. Don't be afraid. You don't need to create nodes. This is only setting for how much elements you want to split one beam. There is one thing. We have these wind bracings. The wind bracings are usually from small cross-section like a circle or an angle, for example. They have very low bending stiffness. And if they get pressure, then the first buckling shapes goes to these very weak beams. And therefore, if you select this beam as axial force only, you can define it in the properties of the beam, then such beams get only one finite element. They are not splitted and they cannot get local buckling lengths. They are every time straight line. So first this definition, you see it in the structure. If you go to the structure, you see this small circle. If the circles are too big for you, then you can go to settings. Usually this is defined for line symbol to 0.3. This is sometimes too big, depend on the size of the structure, but you can make it smaller, line symbols to 0.1. And how to define that this is this truss beam? It's here, FEM type, axial force only. Then such beam gets only one finite element. The definition of the finite element mesh, and we see we want to split each beam to five finite elements. Let's run the mesh calculation only to see it. You don't need to calculate the mesh extra because during the calculation of internal forces, the mesh is generated. So we can say we want to draw the mesh, and for labels for the mesh, we want to see the mesh nodes. And you see these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 elements, and we see only one finite element. So let's deactivate the mesh. And what we need is the functionality for the stability calculation. Of course, we have to put in, I have that deactivated. Usually it's activated automatically if you start a new project. And now we see the stability combinations. So you can read the stability combinations from linear combinations, but our structure is very small and very simple. As I told on the start, the critical Euler form, the critical buckling force is depending on the structure, is not depending from the size of your load. If you create instead of 10 kilonewton, you use 100 kilonewton. For 10 kilonewton, for example, you get lambda for, I don't know, 25. If you select 100 kilonewton, you get lambda 2.5, but you get the same and critical. So the size of the load is not so important for the calculation of buckling length. There is another calculation where you need these coefficients. For example, if you decide if you want to calculate with first order or second order theory, then you have to use these the design loads. And in this case, you have to use the safety factors from the design combination, from the ultimate limit state combination. Okay, now we have the load, we have the mesh, we have to say to the software how much buckling lengths we want to calculate and with which solver. There are more stability solvers. These two are very quick. Sometimes they calculate negative multiplication factors, these buckling factors, because they calculate over the eigenvalue method, and sometimes they get negative values. You can ignore these values. If you don't want to have these values in your output, you can go to polynomial. Iterative is special. It was in the past for large structures where there was not enough RAM. And sometimes if you have very weak structures which are on the boundary to kinematical structures, then the iterative solver is very good. So I use the Lanczos, say for example, 10 buckling modes, and then run the calculation, linear stability calculation. There is also nonlinear stability calculation, but this is not a topic of this video. For us, it's enough. We use this linear. And in the results, we see the 3D displacements. And in the displacement, first we need to see the buckling shape because we need to decide which buckling shape we want to use for the calculation of the buckling lengths. So you select the stability combinations and we have our 10 buckling shapes. I select the first one. You can better you go to this wireframe. It's simple picture. And then you see it's going around strong axis. Okay. From the first buckling shape, we can read the buckling length for the buckling length around strong axis. So let's look on the second. Okay, it's rotation. I would use it for the buckling around weak axis. There is one shape which is better for this weak direction, but the difference between 17 and 19 is not so big, and we are on the safety side if we use this lower value, because with the lower value of this factor, stability combination factor, we get smaller and critical and larger or the bigger buckling length, so we are on the safety side. So for the buckling around strong axis, the first one, around weak axis, the second one, where you can define it, you go to steel, to the member check data, stability member data, and then say, for the buckling around strong axis, the first shape, buckling around weak axis, the second shape. There is a limitation with 10. That means 10 times the system length is the maximum. You can change it if you want. This is only a safety value. So you can select it. Then you have this stability member data, and you can copy this stability member data with copy attributes to another beams. So I use it for this, for these beams. Then we can compare the old calculation and the new calculation, or calculation with the stiffness and calculation with stability. Now go to slenderness. I select all these columns. So on the in the first frame we have calculation from the stability, in the second frame we have calculation from the stiffness. Current around strong axis. So what we have, 2.46, 2.43, small difference. And around weak axis, we have 2.9, 2.8, also a small difference. So this stability calculation is more exact, but you have to decide or define correct load and select the buckling shape which you want to use. There is also library, because we have used for the beam this BG1 for the column, and for the beam this BG2. So you can find it everything on one place in this system length and buckling, the BG1 and BG2. So you can go to the library and change it if you want. If you define both things, so we have defined for this column the calculation from the stiffness, and also calculation from the stability. The stability calculation is more important. So if you define stability values with this SMB, then these are used for the calculation of buckling lengths. You see it also in the output, and that's the end of the of our video. Okay. Look on the preview. You see the all of these formulas for the check of our column, and we see flexural buckling check. This is the system length, buckling length factor, and buckling length and our end critical, which we have calculated from the stability calculation, and this is the calculation. So you can check all these values with this detailed output with tables and formulas, so you see it and you can check. So that's all. I hope it was informative for you and you have learned something. Thank you.